Hi, since some of you asked and I thought it might be interesting, I decided to show you the fusion base we built. With we, I mean Crashrolls Red and I, because Crash wanted to hit the 10 million EU achievement, and so we decided to build the fusion base. What we have here are 128 fusions dedicated for EU production and 18 in the middle to keep everything running. And I decided to show you it and walk through it and talk about it, what was my rationale and how we produced the cells and how we set up everything. Let's start at the ground level. Here's basically all the fusions we stacked. Here we have 16 times 8, 128. That are producing a clean output for the mass fabricator above. And in the middle, we have a tower of 18 that is putting all of its plasma it generates into an ender tank here that is distributing all the plasma for the fusions itself, for the ring fusions, as well as the material production above that I will show shortly. So this 18 fusions powers everything. Yeah, nothing else to see here other than quite a lot of fusions stacked on top of each other. More interesting is the second layer. Looks quite complicated, but it's basically the fuel production of each fusion. I decided to isolate each chunk. So each chunk produces the fuels and cells needed for each fusion tower below. So it's basically, we can look at one chunk and one chunk, it's the same in each other's chunk. With a small difference that the middle chunk is for 18 fusions and the ring 88 chunks are for only 16. So this one is a little bit taller. So how did I calculate the whole thing? I made quite a comprehensive Excel list. I can show you here. Let's look at 16, a tower of 16. I made this Excel here. You can input how many fusions you want, the fuel. We're currently looking at deuterium, helium-3. You can also make deuterium, tritium, but keep in mind that you need quite a lot of more machines. So we opted to use deuterium and helium-3. But you need redstone. And that's why we used witch droppers around. I will show you later. We opted to use three overclockers in the centrifuges and one overclocker in the electrolyzer. Each overclocker adds inefficiency and the power requirement rises quite drastically. I think it's, I wrote it here, double the total EU cost that the machine needs. No, it quadruples, so times 4 the EU per tick and halves the production time. So it's quite important if you want to decrease the amount of machines needed, but you need quite a lot of power in the end. So that's why we built the 18 fusions in the middle, just to keep all the 128 fusions running without having like a ton of centrifuges. For example, if we put zero overclockers in the centrifuges, each chunk would need over 1000 centrifuges times 8. That would be around or over 8K centrifuges. So at a certain point, overclockers really are needed. Yeah. That's how we calculated how many accumulators, industrial electrolyzers we need, and I even made the calculation how many for deuterium, how many for helium-3, and how many for the helium to helium-3 conversion, and how much the power requirements would be. And then you can calculate how many plasma generators you would need for each tower. Yeah, that's how I calculated. If we look at the towers of 16 times 8, we have 128 fusions that generate enough plasma for 4,000 plasma generators, or per tower 500 plasma generators. that produce 1 million EU per tick, or in total 8 million EU per tick. That is important because a mass fabricator can take around 1 million EU per tick as a maximum. After that, everything falls apart and it really can't produce anymore. In theory, it's actually, not in theory, in practice, it's actually 750 to around 900k EU per tick. I will show you later. So that's why we made towers of 16 for mass fabricators. In total, we have 148 if you include the 16 we have here. And everything in total consumes 902k EU per tick just to keep the fuel and the fusions running. So that's what the middle fusion provides. Yeah, let's go back to the game. Each chunk has Aqueous accumulators that provide the water. I made more than are actually needed, just because. And they are filled the industrial electrolyzers here that fill the empty cells into the hydrogen cells. And the hydrogen cells get put into these tower of centrifuges that produce the deuterium. That's one of the fuel. A little bit more different or difficult is the helium. It starts with an ender chest of redstone that is coming from the witches that are dropped here, and end up in a dedicated small ME system that has endstone and produces with this tome of alkahaste that is not used up when it's put in the bottom row. You can basically duplicate or replicate endstone. But you never want to run out of endstone because you need a little bit of endstone to produce 17 times the redstone. But if everything is gone, you don't have endstone to make endstone. So that's why I decoupled it from the rest of the ME system, because that's how I can keep level limiters here. So that if it falls below 4K, it turns off the endstone production for these four that have the output go to this ME systems. So there's always endstone here, and the overproduction or the other thing is going to this ME system. This ME system is putting all the endstone into the rotary macerators. I use 4 transformer upgrades and 12 overclockers just to speed things up, because if we look at the Excel spreadsheet again, we need 2,336 endstone dust per minute that are around 39 per second. So you need quite a lot of speed to keep up with the endstone production if you're powering 16 fusions. And yeah, that's why we use that much macerators and overclockers. Yeah, from there, the endstone dust gets put into this chest, and this chest has a storage bus that is hooked up to this separate ME system. This ME system and this ME system is also separate and decoupled from each other, because the helium that is produced here from the endstone that is handed over through this chest has helium-free cells that can be directly used for the fusion, normal helium cells, tungsten, and sand. And the normal helium cells can be upgraded to helium-free. That is done in this tower here. You can see the centrifuges around here. And these helium, you need 16 to make one helium-free and 15 empty cells. And I want to empty the cells without using an extractor, just to so I can use the helium and not have to throw it away. Because every helium cell basically is redstone I don't want to waste. And I split that, because from there, the helium-free that is produced gets forced down the throat into this chest, basically. And because I use free extractors, it's most likely the first thing that gets input into this chest So that's why in these sentry futures, bad example, the helium-3 should get stacked up because it can't find a place to get extracted from, because these here are prioritized to export into this chest, and only if all the helium is converted to helium-3, the original helium is going into this chest. By the way, I don't use storage drives. I only use storage buses on chests because that gives me a clean limit. The limit is the content of one chest, and it can't produce more than that. So each cell, each type, it's around 7,000, and I get 7,000 deuterium, helium, and hydrogen and dust and everything. It can't produce more deuterium than helium. It basically produces to its limit. It's the limit of the chest and can't produce more. And if you would use a deep storage unit or storage drives, the ratio between deuterium and helium-3 would fluctuate, and you would end up basically with 50k deuterium and zero helium, and your fusion would run out. And if you limit it with level emitters, they might fail because they are really buggy, and it would produce still even if it's instructed to turn off. So it's more stable that way if you just force it, because there's literally no place to put it in. So that's why I use chests. The helium-3 production has sand and tungsten as an output. The tiny little pile of tungsten gets converted here to tungsten dust, and the hydrogen has compressed air cells that get back to empty cells here. And the sand and tungsten is put here into this ender chest, where it gets drained basically. So that's the whole fuel setup. And the cells wander down this ME cable into the fusion itself, where they get put into this router that puts it in the top side of this material injector. And if it produces, or it gets used up, the empty cells get imported again. So you don't use up empty cells. Each chunk uses 50k empty cells, I think. And because it's limited through the chests, it keeps everything in balance. Yeah, that times 9 times per chunk, basically the same thing. Yeah, and the ring fusions, so the towers of 16, provide a clean output of plasma that go up here to a chunk of exactly 500 plasma generators. And these 500 plasma generators, in theory, produce 1 million EU per tick. In actuality, because of inefficiencies, can't ex really explain why, it just falls apart if the network gets too big. In actuality, it's around 800k EU per tick. It fluctuates, sometimes it's 750 to 900k. But that's about the output you would expect from 500 plasma generators directly importing the power into one mass fabricator. But not to complain anything, because the output of U-U-Matter is quite fast at this rate. And 16 fusions, basically, 60 fusion and one mass fabricator produce this much U-U-Matter per second. I would say it's about 4 or 5 per second. It's not actually 1 U-U-Matter per tick, so 20 U per tick, per second. It's close to 4 or 5 per second. I don't know why. We have currently only have 7, not 8 mass fabricator here, and there's 7 here. One is empty. Let's find the empty one here. The 7 that are currently running produce 8.8 million per day on U-U-Matter. And if we would have an 8 mass fabricator, it would be a clean 10 million U-U per day. So the 100 million for the achievement would be doable in 10 days, so a little over a week. That is to say that you actually have a base already built and functional. And this took us 2 weeks to build, but that is to say because I have a base that is able to keep up, and I have quite a lot of tin and copper and iron productions to even make this, and endermans for beryllium cells and iridium and all that. So I would advise, if you want to build a huge fusion base, that you build a base with around 16 fusions yourself and lots of mass or matter fabricators, so you have the starting momentum to build such fusions at a rapid pace, so that you then can build a dedicated fusion base where you can plaster all the fusions you want, basically. Let's look at the control center inside. We also wanted to use the byproducts that land here in the deep storage units in our bases. So I built a drain system, and these levers enable a dark fiber cable that enables the extractors that pull the items into an ender chest. And the bottom row is for Crash Rose Red Space. And if he turns the lever on, he can drain the items. He drains currently the tungsten, the sand, and the gunpowder. And I'm draining on the row above all the glowstone because I need it for gold and redstone. You can macerate it. Currently, we have a buffer of 10 million redstone and close to 50 million EU matter, and we are running it for about a week now and have used some for our own needs. Everything gets imported through these chests here on the wall. These three chests are basically the chests you saw at the fuel production. That's the output of the sand on the tungsten. And these two chests are the redstone, gunpowder, and glowstone from the witch droppers. And this one is the chest that gets filled with the redstone for the fuel production here below, where the endstone is produced. Let's quickly look at the witch droppers. We have 8 per chunk and built a ring around it, around the whole fusion base. Chunk loaded is actually only 3 times 3 in the middle. The fusions are actually chunk loaded with a world ender. And the droppers are around it, not chunk loaded, because it doesn't really matter, because they need a player to be present to even spawn the witches. We made a little bit more than we actually needed. We produce about double the redstone actually needed, but that's actually really cool because that means we need to only chunk load 12 hours a day to keep the fusion running for 24 hours around that. So if you basically chunk load for 4 days, you can keep it running for another 4 days and turn off your PC or something like that. That's how everything gets produced. If you want to have a look at yourself, I made a warp. It's called slash warp wisp party. And you land up here into this temple near the fusion, and you can have a look yourself. Currently, it's the 3rd of July 21. And I don't know how much longer this map will last, but you can look have a look yourself. If there are any questions, just ask. And otherwise, I wish you have a wonderful day and goodbye.